So when I was Protestant, what I saw is kind of freeing in church services was this really this sense of not a complete lack of boundaries, but very few of them. There was no set structure for how our service had to go. It's true that if you showed up on any given Sunday, it would look pretty much the same as all of the other Sundays. A couple of songs, offering, couple of songs, sermon, couple songs, communion, or whatever order those happen to happen in. But I thought that, like, this is what it means to be in Christ, right? That it's just me and Jesus. I don't need anything else. I don't need anybody else. You know, growing up in an a cappella Church of Christ, we didn't even have instruments to get in the way of us and Jesus, right? It was just me and Jesus as an individual. When we went to England and I started to experience more liturgy in the Anglican Church, and then, you know, coming back, I began to realize that this kind of absence of intentional structure wasn't as freeing as I thought it was. And that this me and Jesus attitude that I had, while important to have my own personal relationship with Christ, that wasn't all there was, right? Even, I mean, you know, in college and things, I had recognized at least notionally that we don't read scripture in a vacuum, right? We read scripture with the church. We belong to the church. The church is a community. But still, at the end of the day, I was my source of authority for whatever I wanted to believe on any given subject. I could either listen to the pastor, or because I was an uppity young kid and thought I was smarter than everybody else, I just said the pastor was wrong and I believed whatever I wanted to anyway, and it didn't matter, right? That didn't kick me out of the church, leave me in the church, because it was just me and Jesus. And that's when I started to realize that boundaries, right, these limitations, these things that I saw as trappings, aren't necessarily bad things. What they do is they provide markers for how best to be in Christ, right? So that these rote prayers that I thought Catholics just prayed without ever really thinking about what it is they're saying can be an opportunity to actually have words to say when I don't have any words for myself. Right? Scripture talks about the Holy Spirit groaning on our behalf when we don't have words. That's part of what these rote prayers do for us. They give us words when we don't have them. That the structure of a Mass is intended to lead us through Scripture, through the Christ event, right? You know, from birth to death to resurrection, it's all meant to lead us through that whole process. And this is something that, you know, Protestants were starting to cotton on to a little bit, that they were starting to think, oh, you know, liturgy's good, and we'll have all of our songs be about either the whole creation story, you know, from creation of the world to the resurrection of Christ and the coming again, or they'll at least be on theme with whatever our topic or scripture is. But it was having all of that and then having a real heart to it, which wasn't the sermon, but was Christ, that I began to see, like, oh, these aren't just trappings that are adornments for no real reason. They're an opportunity to actually express these things more fully by having these boundaries to work within. If someone were in a situation like I was, in a, you know, a low kind of Protestant church setting with Hertz a cappella or with music or whatever, and they think that this is the best way to do it, and or maybe they're scared of what, and Mass is kind of scary, right? When do you stand up? When do you sit down? When do you kneel? When do you do whatever, right? The first time I ever went to Mass, I was terrified because I hate not knowing how I'm supposed to behave in a particular setting. It's terrifying. The things I'll say, though, is that first, when it comes to whether it's a praise and, like, worship set, you know, or it's like 30 minutes of music or whatever, those things at the end of the day, they can be great or they can be terrible. I've been in praise bands. I love playing that kind of music still sometimes. And they're great. It can be really wonderful, but it's not all there is, and it's not really the most important thing. Right? Music and these things, they tend to work on our emotions, and that's okay. We're emotional beings. We should have that. But we also have to recognize that we're not only emotional beings, and that we shouldn't be primarily concerned with how does this make me feel in a given moment, but how am I being asked to kind of live in the world, right, through these things. And what I experience at Mass is more of an attempt to get at what's really going on behind everything else, right? Behind the workaday, behind the things that I see with my senses, right? Mass is what happens at Mass is kind of telling me what's going on behind the scenes, right? About God and his angels that are upholding all things, the saints that are constantly praying for us. At a Protestant service, no matter how wonderful the music is, no matter what emotional heights it can take you to, no matter how doctrinally perfect it might be, it can't really give you that sense of the kind of underpinnings of what's actually sustaining reality at every given moment. Mass gone to in the kind of right mindset, it will show you that. And so if you're scared, well, don't be. Most people aren't going to be jerks, and they're not going to yell at you if you stand up at the wrong time, or if you sit down at the wrong time, or if you kneel at the wrong time. And if you have questions, ask them. People will love to talk to you about what's going on. So don't be afraid is essentially the advice. Go try it anyway, and talk to people. And I think, you know, building those relationships are the best way to overcome that uncertainty and that fear about when do I do what.